Hey guys, today we are going to do the field test for Ecoline liquid watercolors and Ecoline brush pins. These pins were purchased out of pocket, not just for the purposes of review. I am a watercolor artist and I do love and enjoy watercolors, but I certainly cannot honestly say I didn't think I was going to review them. So if you enjoy watercolory content, head on over to natasoup.blogspot.com for my watercolor basic series. I take you step by step through every portion of my watercolor process to get you painting. And if you enjoy content like this, don't forget to leave a like, consider subscribing, and head on over to my Patreon for information on how to join the community. So I've got my reference pulled up. I have my succulent inked, and I inked it with the waterproof brush pin, the Sailor Mitsuo Ida. It's one of my favorites. And I'm gonna go ahead and get started. So if you are following along at home, some of the materials you're gonna wanna have handy are, sorry, I'm actually grabbing some of them, some droppers, paper towels, clean water, your brushes. I've also got the Ecoline blender pen, as well as a few watercolor brushes and a watercolor water brush. So hopefully we can try a few different things. And I am in the background, not that y'all can see this, constantly trying to get the sleeves of my outfit rolled up and out of the way. And I am going to start by laying down a wash with three basic colors. And those are 640, 545, and 507. And the way I'm gonna do that is I'm gonna make use of my Ink Essentials Craft Mat, which is what I have here on the tabletop. I'm going to use a clean pipette. I'm gonna pipe a little bit of the concentrated liquid watercolor onto my craft mat. I'm gonna clean out my pipette so I can come back to it later. And if you are an illustrator or an artist who doesn't have a craft mat like this, I really recommend you get one. I got mine from Amazon, and I use the heck out of it. It is marketed to crafters, but if you are a comic artist and illustrator, you will definitely find this handy. If you use watercolors or alcohol markers, you'll for sure find this handy. And if you are a water-based marker enthusiast, this thing is a lifesaver. It really adds a lot of techniques. So I'm gonna go ahead and zoom in and change my camera angle so you guys can see what I'm doing. And using one of my larger watercolor brushes, I'm just going to go ahead and add some water to my, almost said inks. Basically they're inks, they are dye-based watercolors. And I'm going to go ahead, paint a wash here on this succulent, and then I'm gonna float those colors in there and they'll serve as a wash that'll sort of influence my later layers. And this is a technique that I enjoy doing with my watercolors, especially when I'm doing botanical illustration like I am today. And of course, the purposes of this review, one, to review and find out how well these work, but also to teach you guys some techniques. All right, so we're floating this very vibrant blue-green, and you need to keep in mind that watercolors dry lighter than they go down. So if the color seems a bit intense to you, it's gonna dry a little lighter than this. Don't worry too much about that. Okay, next. I'm going to add in some of that purple, and I'm trying to get this done while my paper is wet so that the colors will flow and mix into one another. And I'm trying to stay really loose. And I only applied a wash to the succulent, which sort of helps these colors stay where I put. Now I'm going to clean off my brush and float in some of that pink. I really want to water it down because it is not a particularly strong pink. It just kind of, well, in some areas it's very strong, but for the most part, it just influences the colors. And I am working wet into wet. That means I am applying a very wet paint, in this case, liquid watercolor, with a wet brush onto very wet paper. And I am using fluid paper. You can use a nicer watercolor paper than that. The fluid paper I'm using is just a little cellulose-based watercolor paper. It tends to handle watercolor markers quite well. And since we are using the Ecoline brush pins today, I thought that might be a wise idea. Adding a little bit of the pink into the center of our succulent. Trying to use a fairly light hand to do it. Some of you working along at home might decide that, you know, this sort of tie-dye effect that we've got going on right here looks great and you don't want to work it any further than this, and that is totally fine. This is, after all, your project. If it works for you, I say go for it, leave it. But if you're practicing something, don't be afraid of ruining something because you're here to learn. So I cleaned out my brush and I dabbed it on my paper towel. This creates a thirsty brush. We're going to use this thirsty brush to dab up that excess water. Dab it out onto the paper towel. You want to be gentle because I'm not trying to mix colors. I'm just trying to soak up excess water. And I think I'm going to add a little bit of purple into the heart of this plant. Just a little, can very quickly overwhelm. You could do that at a later stage, but I think the sort of uncontrolled, natural looking blends that you get from adding wet into wet will really help sell this. I really like pushing my paintings almost too far into like the weird or ugly stage, and then adding details and refining them. To something a little closer to what it's supposed to be. I really enjoy that challenge. I think that's a lot of fun, especially when you can still see hints of what you'd originally done underneath. Okay. I'm gonna go in with the green. Darken some of that up as well. And I'm not adding water for the most part. I mean, these are liquid watercolors. I am mostly just adding color right now. And this is called floating. So I'm just floating some color into what I've already done. And letting those colors sort of naturally blend and dissolve. All right, so I'm going to let this dry, and already it's pretty attractive as it is. If you want to stop at this point, that's totally fine, but I'm going to let this dry and I'm going to come back to it. All right, guys, my camera isn't doing this justice, and that is a good reminder that I should pull out the color correction card that your Patreon funds helped pay for so that you guys can experience this in the color it's supposed to be. But the colors, even when dry, are extremely vibrant, more vibrant than I'm used to with regular watercolor. So I'm not used to watercolors that remain this vibrant when they are dry. I guess that is, you know, these are dye-based, so that would make sense. Usually I'm used to working with natural pigments. So one of the things I'm gonna do, this isn't 100% dry. My paper is a little bit buckled. It's still a little cool to the touch, but I'm gonna go ahead and add some water and lift some of the colors, since this did dry, a little more vibrant than I had planned on. And we'll also sort of test, you know, how quick to reactivate these are, because a lot of these dye-based water soluble watercolors, a lot of these synthetic dye watercolors, they're very quick to reactivate when you add water. These are holding forward a little bit better than some of the other ones I've used, holding their color a little better, which, I mean, I can't complain about that. It's making what I'm doing right this second more difficult, but it's not a bad thing. And I'm just using the little water brush that I have. It's actually from the Sketchbox, one of the Sketchbox bonus box things that I paid for, but I am using it to lift up some of the color, not all of it, but some. I'm not trying to blend anything because everything kind of blended well into itself, but I am trying to move a little bit of color so I have room to add and change things. And then I'm going to let this dry a little more, and I can lift some of the color. It's about the same amount of scrubbing as one would do with traditional watercolors, and it's not as muddy as you would get with traditional watercolors, so I can definitely see why brush letters would enjoy this. But if you enjoy like wild synthetic colors, purples and pinks and greens, these might be an excellent addition to your collection. Because they are definitely extremely vibrant. And so far they're performing pretty well. I do need to do a comparison test between these and PH Martin's concentrated radiant watercolors. So I guess I need to draw another succulent and do a comparison, so that we're comparing apples to apples, because sometimes it's hard for me to tell you guys, you know, unless I'm like doing a direct comparison, it can be hard for me to make a correlation or a comparison to let you guys know which ones work best. So I will have to do that in the future because I'm curious. And I also want to know how compatible they are with each other, because I did buy colors that are a little different than in my PH Martin set. So it would be really awesome if they're all compatible. I mean, I have a good feeling they are. The PH Martins are a little more prone to lifting. When I did that spread for Viz's Search for Cat Bug book, I used the PH Martins in my watercolor piece, and I did have some trouble with them lifting, and I had trouble with layering because they were lifting more than I was used to. So I do remember that being an issue then. I do handle my watercolors a little bit differently now. So maybe that won't be an issue now. I'm half tempted just to like let this dry all the way and then go back to painting it later, because I'm not as successful at removing as I had hoped to be. And they're pretty much staying in place. Even if I were scrubbing traditional pigment-based watercolors this much, they would be muddy. Like these colors would all have turned to mud. So you can't do what I'm doing with traditional watercolors, so. Magic of dyes. Anyway, I'm going to let this dry and I will resume recording shortly. All right, so I'm going to resume painting. It is mostly dry. It is pretty dry. I would say it's dry, I guess. And I am a little bit hesitant because I am looking at how saturated these colors are and I'm looking at my image and I'm like, how am I going to sort of merge the two together into something that works? Because I went a little dark because I was treating this, or I am treating this, have been treating this, the way I would treat normal watercolors. And that's not really a system that works too well for Ecoline markers. So I am prepping a very light green. It is spring green. And I'm gonna grab my chartreuse marker as well as my, which one are you? I think you're red violet. And a couple of my blues and a purple. Have those on the ready, as well as my blender pen. And I'm going to try something out and it might not work. I'm gonna use the blender pen in some of my spring green. So I picked up a fair amount of color here and I'm going to try brushing that in, and that seems to work without any real problem. So if you already have the Ecoline, if you already have the bottles of Ecoline paint and you don't have the markers, something I think you can get away with is using the blender marker as sort of a catch-all marker, which expands the use of your collection, in my opinion. And Ecoline seems to have a foam rubber nib, so they hold up a little bit better. And you can clean your nib off on a paper towel. So I am applying that spring green. Probably even do color blends like this, where you pick up two different colors and let them blend on the marker and as you apply them. And of course, as you use your color, it is going to sort of blend out of your marker. So as it's doing that, I'm also going back and blending it into the surrounding area a little bit. And I bet this blender would work with the radiant watercolors we were just talking about. There's actually a few types of concentrated liquid watercolors on the market. I also have the Blick ones, and those are really more for like very young students. They're kind of syrupy and thick. They're very concentrated. Maybe I just need to super water them down. But I don't think this would really work with that, given how thick those are. Now I am getting some color displacement as I use this blender marker here on the, sorry about that, on the surface. So you know how I was trying to push color with my, with the water brush and it wasn't working? The blender marker seems to have a little bit more of an effect with color pushing. So it's a little bit like, so with a mat like this Craft Essentials, or I'm sorry, Ranger Ink Essentials mat, you can sort of use it as a palette and it'll change how you're able to apply color directly to your image. So I could scribble some of those watercolor markers on the mat and pick some of that up with this blender marker, and I would put down a diluted version of that color. And it wouldn't have quite the dry time that using a water brush would. So it adds a lot of variety, I think, to how one might apply color to an image, which might be of interest to those of you who are stampers. All right, that's getting a little bit muddy. So I'm wiping off my blender marker onto my Viva paper towel, and those are some of my favorite paper towels to use, and it comes out pretty much clean. I'm gonna switch over now to using this purple here. I'm making a little bit of a mess. It's a little muddier than I thought it would be. And I'm going to use my water brush, which has been filled with clean water, to blend this out a bit and give me a softer line, a more watercolor effect than the blender brush will. So it's neat that these markers seem to work well both with a water brush and with the blender. That tends to be unusual with these kinds of markers, at least I've found. Usually you can have one or the other. We have hit the ugly stage of the painting where it looks more like a tie-dye mess than it looks like a multicolored succulent. Go in with that blue purple. Some of that down here as well. So perhaps what works best with these is pick a method of blending and stick with it. So if you want a marker effect, then stick with the blender. And if you want a watercolor effect, then stick with your water brush or your watercolor markers. I mean watercolor brushes. Of course, you can, with judicious application of details, you can pull your piece from the ugly phase, sometimes kicking and screaming. And whenever I get a little too much, I'm using a purple right now, not the marker purple, but the Ecoline liquid purple. If I get too much on my brush, I dab it off. I clean it off onto my paper towel, which is just slightly out of shot for you guys. trying to leave a rim of that bright sort of tie-dye-ish effect that I inadvertently applied. That seems to be working well, but it looks like I'm gonna need some more of my purple. So anyway, I'm going to work on tidying this up with a darker purple in time lapse, and I will check in with you guys after I've... guys, so I finished applying that layer of color, and I actually worked several colors in while it was wet, and that's how we're getting sort of that scintillating watercolor-esque look with the harder lines. And I allowed it to dry, and I'm going to blend a few of them out just a little bit to soften some of that transition. And I'm also going to go in with a couple of the blue markers and just sort of add some low lights in certain areas. So I'm going to go ahead and do that in time lapse, since it's not a particularly difficult procedure, and I'm sure you guys can figure out how to do it as well. And I may also, while I'm doing those things, add some pops of that bright pink back in, since they got a little lost. Guys, so I'm going to paint in the background using a combination of the Ecoline markers in chartreuse, burnt umber, and I might even use burnt sienna. Is this burnt umber? No, yellow ochre. I'm so sorry. The blending pen, oh, as I throw it all over the thing, the blending pen and some of the sap spring green that I already have on the tabletop. And I'm not trying to recreate the background in the photo. I'm just trying to create a believable and sort of contrasting background to what I have here. And I'm going to go ahead and do that in time lapse. Thank you. right, guys, so the background has been applied and it is dry. Of course, with me, you know, once I announce that, I'm like, oh, I can touch all these things up now. So I'm just blending a couple of these things kind of lightly. And I'm going to go ahead and I'm going to start using mixed media on this. And I'm going to begin with color pencil. And I'm just going to do a soft layer on here. Now zoom in so you guys can see it better. And I'm going with color pencil because while these liquid watercolors tend to stay in place a little bit better than some of the other brands I have used, if you really scrub them and they've got a lot of layers, which they do now, you can really make a muddy mess. And I have a few areas here which have already gotten really muddy because I've done too many layers. So I don't really want to use a pencil that I would be tempted to blend out with watercolor because that would just exacerbate the problem. So Derwent Color Softs are very soft color pencils. They are made by the same company that makes Inktense watercolor pencils, which are some of my favorite watercolor pencils. Though I cannot say I love all their products because I am really not a fan of their regular watercolor pencils at all. But I do like the color soft. Now for this to work, your paper does need to be fairly dry. Because you are applying a layer of wax on your paper, and mushy paper doesn't take wax very well. So I'm just going to add sort of a soft layer of white on top of all of the leaves that need it. And that's going to change the contrast on this image quite a bit. So I will continue this in time lapse. Okay, so here comes the scary part. I am going to use this pigmented white Ecoline watercolor. It is the only pigment-based watercolor in their Ecoline brand that I am aware of. I'm gonna use a thirsty brush to apply it because it can actually have better, it has better water control than a water brush does, which sometimes will just leak water. And this might not turn out very well. We're gonna find that out together, really. And I'm gonna try to be ginger about it. And I'm going to start it off just in regular video. And that way, if I catch anything early on, I can comment on it. Doesn't seem to be too much of a problem, I think, if I try to blend it out, as I am about to do with this thirsty brush. Okay, so as long as the brush is really thirsty, it'll work. What my concern is, I don't want to activate the layers underneath it too much. I don't mind if the color comes through. That's not the problem. The problem is if colors start getting really muddy. So I'm going to try and use a really delicate hand, but I can already tell, like right down here, which you guys can't really see because I'm zoomed out so far so you guys can see what I'm doing. It did activate the color underneath a little bit, so I do need to be careful. Now this isn't as opaque as other white sort of corrective medium like Copic Opaque White or Pro White or White Gouache. So I'm starting with it because I thought I could kind of layer it, and hopefully that'll prove true. Layer it and you'll see the colors underneath is what I'm going for here. Because you can water down and use other additive whites in a similar way, but this is just directly from the bottle, not diluted at all, and it seems to be working okay. And I may even be able to paint a little bit on top of it if I really wanted to get like a few very striking colors. So I'm going to zoom in and work on this in time lapse and check in with you guys after it's done. So I've already started kind of going in with green and with pink and sort of going over some of the white just a little bit, just trying to reinforce, re-add some of those colors we had started with that got kind of lost a little bit. And these seem to go over the Derwent Color Soft all right. Not having too much resist problems. I'm starting to get a chalky look. I'm probably overworking this by a lot, so I will probably need to call it quit soon. But I thought overpainting might be something you guys needed to see, just in case you decide you need to go back and add some color or reinforce something, you know, maybe correct something, add a different saturation. And it looks like you can indeed do that with these watercolors. So I know that'll be useful information for some of you. I'm gonna go ahead and let this finish drying now, and then I'm gonna come back in with a very much opaque white, like Copic Opaque White, and just add the finishing touches. All right, guys, our watercolor has had a chance to dry. I've noticed that there is some color, some muddiness. It looks like maybe the white bled out where I tried to add additional color. So I'm going to go ahead and go back in with the markers and tighten that up a little bit. Then I'm going to end with some Copic Opaque White. And the markers seem to go over the Derwent pretty well. But if you're adding color on top of the white, you are going to get some, let me see if I can zoom in for you guys. You're gonna get some bleeding as it bleeds out into the pigmented paint. So if that is a concern, you should be aware of that. But honestly, you can get that effect if you've just painted too many layers, or if you're painting over an opaque paint with a slightly translucent paint, or, you know, fully translucent paint. So it can happen even in regular watercolor applications. Zooming because you guys are kind of losing the image a bit. All right, I think we are just about done here. markers are definitely fun to play with, as are the watercolors, but I think the markers might just be a little more fun. So I'm gonna grab a synthetic brush, if I can find one, in my Can Ooh watercolors. And I want a synthetic because it is heavy enough to deal with Copic Opaque White. Just gonna add a little bit here and there. Help pop that contrast that I've been kind of fighting with back and forth. Don't normally do my succulent studies in watercolor because sometimes it can be hard for me to get all the color I need in there without it getting muddy. And watercolor just handles differently from alcohol markers. But these were a lot of fun, a lot of really bright, brilliant colors. And I look forward to getting to mess with these a little bit more, getting to know them better. Of course, since they were purchased out of pocket and not sent care of, it's going to take me a little bit longer to get to know them, since I'm going to have to collect them as I can afford them or as I encounter them. I ordered the set I have, and I kind of ordered them, well, I definitely actually ordered them open stock. There is no kind of to that. I ordered them open stock. I didn't get a set. I ordered them from Dick Blick, which is not a sponsor of this channel, but I do reference them pretty frequently, don't I? So I'll probably keep an eye on Blick and see if they have a sale. And when they do, I'll pick up a few more, probably in skin tones, because I ordered some pretty wild colors, but not really anything that could be used as a skin tone out of the gate. Although I do have carmine and yellow ochre. And those are two colors that can be used to mix some skin tones, but I don't have any, I didn't order any browns except for burnt sienna. So I definitely need to add some browns to my collection before I can start painting or trying to paint people. They may not even have any decent browns. Didn't really check at the time. I was so enamored with all the bright colors. Do you guys know how that can be? I'm gonna go over some of these areas that I've hit with the opaque white with one of the pinks to add some of that vibrant pink back in. Otherwise, I'm pretty satisfied with these, and I enjoyed playing with them. And I hope that you guys found this helpful and useful. I hope those of you who are interested in brush lettering will give them a shot, because they have that very flexible nylon foam tip, which makes them pretty desirable in my book, because I love those nylon foam tips. They're very resilient. Just blending that Copic Opaque White out a little bit so it doesn't look too much like a touch-up job. It looks more like gouache. I think Copic Opaque White handles a little bit better than their opaque white, but it could just be familiarity on my part. So I'm going to add those touches of pink off camera because I have been working on this for a while and it's just time to move on. So I hope you guys have a great evening. I want to thank you guys so much for watching me field test the Talents Ecoline liquid watercolors, and watercolor markers. If you enjoyed this video, if you found it helpful, if you found it useful, if it helped answer some questions that you might have had about this product, please take a moment to let me know. Since this was not a sponsored review, it would help me out a lot if you took a moment to drop a line to either Dick Blick or Talons and let them know that you really enjoyed this field test slash review and that it really inspired your opinion. And that way they will know. Yeah, because there's no other way for them to know unless you tell them that it helps you. So that would help me out a lot. If you have any questions or suggestions, if you want to see me do something specific, let me know in the comments below. I'll try to get back to you as soon as possible. And if you enjoy content like this, you can find more of it here on the channel by digging through my playlist. There are several of them that would be of interest to you, including alcohol markers and watercolor tutorials. And checking out my blog at natosoup.blogspot.com, because this is part of my watercolor basics series, which is a long-running ongoing series that teaches people how to paint with watercolor. And it's coming from the point of view of a comic artist and an illustrator rather than a fine artist painter. So if you are a stamper, if you're a card maker, if you're somebody who enjoys watercolor, enjoys marker, but you wouldn't consider yourself a fine artist, you don't really have any desire to do that, if you like comics, anything like that, I highly recommend you go check it out. It is designed to help people who know are starting from ground zero, have nothing, no experience at all. And it's kind of my baby. So, you know, if you go check that out, it would really mean a lot to me and it helped me out a whole lot. And if you enjoy that series, take a moment to drop me an email and let me know that it's helped you out, because those kind of series are really time consuming and they're really difficult and frustrating to write. So I do need some feedback. Anyway, last way you can help, if you are so inclined, is to head on over to my Patreon at patreon.com/natosoup and join the art nerd community. Their funds are what goes to help purchase the supplies for these sort of reviews. It helps me make the time for these sort of reviews, helps me make the time to edit. So if you appreciate content like this and you want more of it, joining that community is a great way to ensure that you will continue to get content like this. So I hope you guys have a great day. I will see you later. Bye. Hey guys, so I just noticed something while I was picking my stuff up. Let me move this painting I just completed on video. You guys can check and should check that video out, because it is about the same type of marker. We're talking Ecoline brush markers, and this is the blender marker. So as you guys see, there is a tip, but I want to show you guys something that I just discovered. First of all, you can unscrew these. So theoretically, these are refillable. Haven't seen the refills yet. Maybe you could just refill them from the bottle if you have the bottle of ink, which would be really cool. There would be no other watercolor markers currently on the market that do that. So that would be something. But look. There's another brush in there. So you could use tweezers, like the Copic tweezers, to pull that out. B, it screws off from the cap. You could refill this theoretically. So if you have the matching ink, the matching color, the matching watercolor, sorry, you could use an eyedropper and refill your Ecoline brush pens with your Ecoline watercolor. How cool is that? There are currently no other watercolors on the market that you can do that with. Now, I don't know what you can refill the blender with. I don't know if the blender is just water. Or some glycerin water mix. I'm not even concerned about that, because I am so thrilled with the fact that you could refill your brush pens. So I think you can. You can with the blender. Let's find out with this color. Yep, there it goes. I'm gonna hold it upright because I'm not that foolish. But yeah, isn't that cool, guys? I thought you would find that helpful and useful. So that was a quick tip. Bye.